in good coughing and sneezing etiquette, wearing face coverings on public transport and in indoor retail spaces, and limiting our social contacts. We are still in this together. For more information, go to gov.ie. Supported by the Government of Ireland.
The Saturday panel on Off the Ball.
Welcome back to Off the Ball Saturday here on News Talk. John Duggan with you through till 5 o'clock. You can text us on 53106. Just some breaking news. Maurizio Sarri sacked by Juventus after that Champions League exit at the hands of Lyon last night. A text in here. Lad, Sarri getting sacked is madness. The players just didn't get a style of play, and a big part of why is Ronaldo. His stats are crazy, but at this stage of his career, he can't do what Sarri needs in terms of pressing. He doesn't want to play the way Sarri needs, and he seemed to just do what he wanted. I wonder, is Antonio Conte going to end up at Juventus? And mad stuff, the managerial merry-go-round. So we're streaming live now as well, as you can listen to us in News Talk. We're streaming as well on the Off The Ball social channels. For Periscope, on Twitter, at Off The Ball, on YouTube and on Facebook. We're also streaming on the new OTB Sports app. So search OTB Sports in your app store now to download it. I think one thing we're really missing at the moment is a Championship Sunday. It really is a shame that we don't have any inter-county matches on the weekend. Obviously, public health is the most important thing. We've got our own unique stamp on Gaelic games here at Off the Ball here on News Talk. Tommy Walsh, Kieran Donaghy, Maura Trasany, Callie calling it every Sunday. But we're also mature enough to recognise the contribution of those voices that crackle over the airwaves on throughout the country on local radio. So tell us some tales, to discuss what life is like in clubs right now. We're joined by Oisin Kelly, who calls it in Donegal for Highland Radio. Liam Spratt, who's been commentating on Wexford GAA for South East Radio for 30 years. And Willie Quinlan, who used to play for the Carlow Senior Footballers, was also in an All-Ireland club final with Éire Óg. And Willie now knows, obviously, all things Carlow for KCLR. Lads, hope we're all well. Willie, we're just going to start with you. When we see matches in Laois and Offaly, in Kildare this weekend, off due to coronavirus outbreak, Carlow so close as well, there's got to be a worry over club games in your area and perhaps even the staging of the Intercounty Championship. So, Willie, what is the lie of the land like in Carlow at the moment of the club scene?
Yeah, it's hugely worrying, I suppose. Greg travelled to Port Laois last night and they were warming up and the game was called off, I suppose, 20 minutes before the whistle blew. So they were very, very upset coming away from it, I suppose, after putting in so much work and getting lads back in the field. And locally here, it's much the same. It's everybody is so unsure of what's going to happen and not going to happen. And we had our own case in locally here. O'Loughlin had a case of COVID, and they played two practice matches, which brought two other clubs into it. And the chap that was involved in it also played hurling, and he was involved in some coaching. So it's a big worry, I suppose, you know, not just locally, but the whole country, so uncertain what's going to happen at the moment. It looks like, you know, most championships mightn't even go ahead. If you look at Timahoe are going into isolation, they're in Laois. O'Loughlin, as I say, they had to go into isolation. Collection are the same, just on the borders in Laois as well. So if it keeps going the way it's going, I can't see our championships or any other championships in the country being played, John.
Yeah, there's got to be a worry as well, Willie, that like without gate receipts for clubs, the ability to fundraise, you know, big GA fundraisers, say, to race day, no increase in the limit of 200. And all these are legitimate reasons for public health, right? Is it affordable? Is it worth the while almost of the county boards and the clubs to get this going, you know?
It's probably not really. And going back to our own club, we played a practice match there possibly 2 weeks ago against Ballymun. Now, normally there'd probably be 700 or 800 at these matches. We ended up obviously with probably 120, and then you have your players, mentors, referees, and whatever. So that brings it up to 200. It's probably not feasible, you know, going to games. You're going to Dr. Cullen Park, maybe a championship game, and there's probably 120 going to be at it. I mean, I think listened to Michael Deignan there last weekend, and he said it should be judged on the size of the grounds. If the grounds are able to hold maybe 20 or 30,000, surely you can get 1,000 into it. But health and safety is health and safety, and the players' welfare is more important, I suppose, than money. It's a difficult time for GAA, and for, I suppose, not only GAA, but, you know, pubs being closed back down, restaurants being closed in the likes of Laois and Kildare and Offaly. And everybody's just taking a hit at the moment, and it's just so uncertain, John. We're not really sure about the GAA. It was great to get back down because... Yeah. Or to get back playing, get back in the field and see the young lads training. But if it's, you know, if somebody gets really sick and they bring it home and maybe give it to somebody with an underlying condition and something worse happens, I mean, the GAA could have a lot to answer for then after that.
Yeah, and I think, would you praise the way they've been handling this over the last few months? I think they've done a good job. They've erred on the side of caution, and actually, when you look at it now, that's probably the right thing to do.
I think so far they were very, very good. I mean, I go to matches all over the place, and was at three matches this week, and every club is the same in Carlow. You're only allowed 200, and the 200 is including, as I say, both teams, mentors, whatever. So you're probably getting maybe 100, 120 at games. And GAA have been very good, you know, up to now, and hopefully we can remain and keep the same. And even you know, our lads training, everybody, you're washing your hands on the way in. There's no dressing rooms being open. You're bringing your gear, into the grounds. You're gone straight away after an hour and a half. So, you know, locally, the clubs locally are definitely, you know, in Carlow are doing their utmost best, you know, to do the right thing, and they seem to be doing it at the moment.
You've seen players opting out just because, you know what, I don't think this is the right thing to do.
I've seen one of our county players, probably one of our best players, Paul Broderick at the moment, who lost his spleen there a couple of years ago through a football incident. And he just couldn't afford to play because if he got the COVID, he just wouldn't be able to fight it. So he's definitely said he's not going to play club or county this year, and really you can't blame him.
We're going to get into touch with Liam Spratt and Oisin Kelly just in a moment. But Willie, we'll just continue with you here. How did you kind of progress from being a long-time player with the Carlow Senior Footballers, you're playing in All-Ireland Finals for Arrow, to being the man behind the mic in KCLR? How did that kind of work out for you? Were you approached? Were you interested? How did it get off the ground?
Yeah, it was actually just approached by a local guy here, Brendan Hennessy, who I would know for a long, long time. And he just said to me, would I be interested? He said, listen, you're at most of the matches, so you know the game inside out. You just look at the games and, you know, say what you see. Now, sometimes I can be a little bit too honest, and so some people don't like that, I suppose, in you know, commentators or one thing or another. But I actually, after about 3 or 4 games, I really took to it, really enjoyed it, love every minute of it, and really missed it while it was away. I mean, we're in the middle of it. I think the last time I'd seen Liam Spratt was back in February when Wexford beat Carlow, actually, in Wexford in the National League. And since then, you just haven't seen anybody. There's been no games, nothing on the radio. They're getting back locally. All the games are being covered. So I'm hoping when the football comes back in a couple of weeks that I'll get the show to do the local radio for our local GAA here as well.
Do you think, though, that's a good point of difference to have? For me, when I think about the Weeshie Fogartys, the great late Weeshie Fogarty of Kerry, Willie Hegarty out in Shannonside, these kind of brilliant local legends, that really are the authority in the area for Gaelic games, just as much as Micheál and Mura Hirsig would have been nationally for so many years. I think you do have to be, in a way, a little bit distinguishable from, say, the Micheál and Mura Hirsigs. And you know what? Calling for your county or for your club or whatever, there's no bad thing in that.
No, it's absolutely brilliant. And you get a certain amount of respect, I suppose, after playing, as you said yourself, in All-Ireland Club Final and playing with the county for a number of years. And people tend to listen. And, you know, most of the comments come back is, you know, are very good. You will get an odd one, I suppose, from different clubs that'll say, oh, he's very hard on such a one, or very hard on this one. But I think locally, when you have a local guy or a couple of local guys, people do listen. And it's amazing, you know, when you're out about, you know, around the town, I heard a match the other night, it was very good, I couldn't get to it. And it's really, in this time, I suppose, it's really going to help people. If only 200 can get to games, people are going to tune into local radio and listen to their matches. I mean, that kind of, I've just spoken to a guy, Joe Walsh is his name. His son plays for Tullerone, fullback. He was actually man of the match there last Friday week. And he said he got a ticket for last Friday week, but he's out of hat now. So he doesn't get another ticket until maybe a couple of weeks' time down the line, whether they get to semi-finals or finals. So for him, he's going to have to tune in to local, you know, KCLR, whoever is covering the match. and listen to it. So for the benefit of those guys, I think it's really, really good to have local radio and local guys being involved in it as well.
Do you think streaming then can possibly work on a long-term basis? We see Tipperary GAA streaming at the moment. The League of Ireland stream seems to be in a pleasant surprise for a lot of people in soccer. I think there could be something in that for club GAA.
Yeah, definitely. It definitely could be the way forward. When you have guys that can go to a game, they don't need much equipment to live stream, I suppose, and people are able to pick it up and they're able to see their club games. If you see Facebook now, I watched the end of a game there. I think it was St. Joseph's against Ballyroan. Ballyroan got a last-minute goal to beat St. Joseph in the championship, and it was live streamed. And it's fantastic. You don't have to go to the games. You can sit in your own kitchen or your backyard or wherever and watch these games. I think it's fantastic. It is the way forward, definitely, John.
When you were involved in Éire Óg, Willie, in the 90s, would you have noticed the local radio station? I don't know if it was KCLR back then, but would they have followed the path of, to be fair, like with Bolton Glass winning with Wicklow in 1990, there is a better chance sometimes from a club from a so-called weaker county to progress through the All-Ireland Series.
Yeah, definitely. If you look at the likes of the Carlows, the Wicklows now, we're miles and miles off winning any All-Irelands, or the way Dublin are going, even a Leinster, or getting to a Leinster final. If you got a lucky draw, you might get to a Leinster final, but Dublin are the kingpins of football, not just in Leinster, but in the country for the last five, maybe 6 or 7 years. So it is back to the club scene. And definitely, when we were coming out, we got to five Leinsters and won five Leinsters. It just took off, really, the whole local thing took off. I mean, KCLR at that time followed, as they do, any club that does well. Mount Leinster Rangers got to an intermediate final as well, won the intermediate, got to the senior final and were beaten on the day. But the local stuff really gets behind it. And as well as that, everybody starts taking notice and stand up and looking at the players, and everybody knows you in the town. You know, there's not one club or county, I suppose, that wouldn't support you and wouldn't follow you when you do get far. So for that point of view, it is fantastic to be a club player and get to a Leinster, win a couple of Leinsters, and even push on and play in an All-Ireland final. It has to be fantastic.
Did it change the town? Did it change the vibe of the town? We're talking like all the moment about Italia 90 and all that kind of thing for the nation, but even for a town like Carlow, because I believe Éire Óg is quite close to the town.
Yeah, it actually changed our mindset in the town, where we started to believe that we could actually win club championship. Never quite did. We got to two All-Ireland finals and were beaten in the two of them. But it just changes your mindset to think, well, a couple of years after that, O'Hanrons here, local club as well, they went on and won their Leinster, Michael Dempsey at the helm. So it just gave the county a real self-belief that, why can't we? Why can't we do it? I watched the Sean Boylan story the other night, which was fantastic as well. And I mean, Meade were in a bad place at the time, and look at the record. He 23 years, I think, 4 All-Ireland, 6 Leinsters and 4 league titles. And he probably just gave them that bit of self-belief that they needed, and that's what it gave us in the town here.
Yeah, Sean Boylan, what an absolute legend. And what I was thinking about that win you had over Kildare a couple of years ago, Willie, with Carlo in the championship, and the giant killing. And for me, that at a time, maybe in the 80s, okay, they'd won All-Irelands before that, but it was a bit of a surprise for them to break through against Dublin in 1986. We had the GPA coming out yesterday with this proposal around the championship being reduced to 23 weeks from February to July, and then having the club scene between July and December. Would you favour a restructure of the championship, or do you think the giant killing days are so important still for a county like Carlow?
I think it's really, really important that everybody gets to play in the championship. If you're beaten, you go out of the championship and maybe go into a B championship, whatever, but you have to get your day out. It's what every supporter and every player trains for, to get to that championship, in around May. Carlow, as you say, turned over Kildare. It definitely wasn't expected. We didn't expect it. I don't think too many gave them a chance. And it was just incredible scenes after the match. I mean, during the match, it wasn't until Conor Lawler scored the final goal that we could actually celebrate, because we knew the game was over then. Kildare were never going to come back. At all stages, we were waiting for it's going to be a goal, there's going to be a goal, Kildare are going to come back, and it didn't happen. So for those players, to go through that and go through the emotions after it and during the game, I mean, you can't take that away for from the weaker counties and decide, right, where there's going to be two-tiered, there's only going to be maybe 16 or whatever top teams in the championship. I think it would be, you know, a devastation for the local football, because this is what these guys, you play the league and you hope you do well. You know, Division 1 hope to stay in Division 1 and 2 and 4 hope to, you know, can get into 3. But when it comes to the championship, you're looking at the draw and you're looking at, you know, maybe we have a chance. And that's been, you know, there for years and years. And when you get a day out like that, it's just so memorable. And, it's, you know, for us on the radio to cover it, it was incredible.
Was it the most memorable day, Willie?
I definitely think one of them. There was another day that stands out, and it had to be Carlo played Loud. You know, obviously Loud, I think they're after beaten in the Leinster final the previous year. When I say beaten, I think Meath threw the ball over the line. Big Joe had it in his hands lying in the square. So they were very unlucky that day. So again, Loud probably would have been favourites. It looked like Loud were going to win on the day, but Brendan Murphy kicked the point, you know, nearly from 40, definitely 45, 50 yards out to actually win the game. And again, you know, the madness that happened after the game was just incredible as well. So those 2 days definitely stick out. Kildare probably, being that Kildare, I would rate them probably in top three in Leinster still. You know, we hadn't beat them since 1955. So it was an incredible day. I think probably was one of the best days on local radio, yeah.
And there must have been some mad days. If you're covering all these, like I was just speaking to the producer there a moment ago, you know, you must have some mad days as well. What's the maddest day you've had?
The maddest day, as
in like the maddest moment, mad things you've seen on the pitch. Like you're covering loads of club games. You're probably dealing with a lot of characters. Any kind of anything that stands out, which is just a bit off the wall.
Actually, that day against Loud, when Brendan Murphy kicked the winning point, I actually jumped off. I jumped off my stool and I had my young fellow with me. I think he was about 4 at the time. And I knocked him onto the ground, never even seen him, just continued commentating. Went into a rant, I'd say, for about 2 or 3 minutes. The guy that was actually commentating, he just stepped back. Can't think of his name, though. I think it was from Watford. He just stepped back and let me on. And I just pure raw emotion, just kept going and going and going. And sure, it went viral. Obviously, it hit the network all over the country.
Let's see if we can. Do we have that Willie Quinlan audio there ready there, just to play that audio just of that momentous day?
But it's gone to John Murphy. Look who's coming forward, Horst Lawler. He can wrap it up into Lemore. Horst goes for the shot. It's a
yes!
And a big
yes!
goal to the side. They wrote them off everywhere. 2:14 to 1:10. This is Carlo's day. I hope we're enjoying this one.
I just want to play a bit of Liam Spratt as well there, Willie, who's been doing it for 30 years. Let's see if Liam can match that.
It's not here. It's in the net. It's in the net. It's in the net. The ball is in the net. It's a goal for Wexford. It's in the net. 1:13 to 1:5. Superb finish. It might have been Conor McDonald. It might have been Conor McDonald that got in there.
Liam Spratt, how are you?
Hiya, John. How are you today?
Yeah, good, thanks. We're having a great chat with Willie Quinlan there from KCLR about local GAA. Obviously, a lot of uncertainty at the moment in the country with this COVID outbreak and how clubs are getting on. And then Willie telling us the story about how he got involved from being a Carlo player to a commentator. How is the lie of the land there in Wexford for you at the moment, Liam?
First of all, Willie is mad anyway, John, so it helps.
Good mad, I would say.
And I'm a little bit mad as well, I suppose. The advantage of local guys like ourselves is that we're allowed to be as biased as be damned, so we get away with it. But we've had the Senior Hurling Championship, John, we had the first quarterfinal last night, the county champions beaten by Glenbarrentown, which was a surprise. Jason Ryan is involved with Glenbarrentown, and he had a nice game plan. We've a lot of former inter-county managers involved in Wexford. John Myler was with Dan Barton, so we had a very... standard of hurling has been fantastic, John, and the standard of the intercounty players has been fantastic because they're fresh, they haven't played with their counties, and it's the first time we've ever played a quarter-final matches in August, and, you know, there's going to be a lot of lessons learned from this, I think, by county boards and by Croke Park in terms of fixtures and so forth.
And Oisin, up in Donegal, how's it going out up there for you?
Hey, John, how's things?
Yeah, good, thanks.
Sun's shining, so things are good, John.
Ah, sure, look.
Doesn't happen too often up here.
Are you getting club games off the ground, Oisin?
Yeah, we're up and running, John. We've got club games, two rounds now. We're into the second round, actually. We've one round completed. The second round started last night. So there's a change to the club structure in Donegal, and it's like the rest of the counties around the country have changed things to adapt to the 11-week period that they have. So they've gone away from the groups and they've decided to play round-robin games over four rounds and then go into knockouts. So we've started the second round, and the big game so far of the opening two rounds was on actually last night, where St Unions were playing Kilkeare, two sides that have won the Donegal Championship before. It turned out to be a share of the spoils, a draw, 1-9 apiece. Kilkeare were leading up by 7 points at the start of the second half and let St Unions back in it, and the last score of the game was a goal to tie it all up. So yes, it's good to have Championship back. The Championship excitement is there, but as we all know, we're all doing it in different surroundings. So we are with the limit of people there, which sort of takes away from the atmosphere a bit. But it's good to have football again, John. That's the main thing.
Are the players buying into it? Are they worried? Are the regulations good up there, Oisin? Is there a fear that this might be all called off? Or where are you at the moment with that?
Well, talking among the press last night, the Donegal press, that fear seems to have grown, particularly what we've seen, John, in the last couple of days, and the three counties, Kildare, off the leash, where the numbers have gone up, sport has been halted, daily life has been halted. So is this now a warning? Is this a sign of what's going to come? Some are suggesting and some are worrying that there may not be any inter-county football come the end of October, when we're due to get underway with the Championship here for Donegal, who's scheduled to play Tyrone. With two league games, of course, penciled in for that as well. Will that happen? If these numbers keep rising and this OR number increases, I don't think it's going to happen. But as for the club players, certainly they're buying into the Championship. They're giving it everything that they have. They want club football. There was such a delay for so long, John, that really there was a huge eagerness there for everybody to get back, and the club players are definitely getting stuck under the Championship.
Well, I want to get to the nitty-gritty of more of these brilliant moments that you guys have had covering your county, Oisin Kelly, Liam Spratt and Willie Quinlan, after the break, after the news. Stick with us on the Saturday panel here, and thanks so much for your time this afternoon here on News Talk Off the Ball. Text in here in 53106, Garden County Sports doing a brilliant job streaming club championship games in Wicklow. Nice job, Tubber and the team. That is from Gavin in Wicklow. And John Pottypammer from C103 Cork, another great commentator on local radio. Regards from Mike. 53106 on the Saturday panel, back after this.
The Saturday panel on Off the Ball.
Forward. It's the one move we're all ready to take. And at the Audi Moving Forward sales event, we're ready to help you on that journey. All Audi dealerships are now open, with tailored solutions to suit your individual needs, like the Audi A6 Saloon, with PCP finance from only €499 per month. Now is the time to make an appointment. Now is the time to start moving forward. Audi. Vorsprung durch Technik. Finance provided by way of hire purchase agreement from Volkswagen Financial Services Ireland, subject to lending criteria, terms and conditions apply. Visit audi.ie/A6 2020 for further information.
Screen Time with John Fardy.
This week on Screen Time, a personal look at the greatest movie scenes of all time.
I believe in America.
It's those moose calls that open your ears at 2 o'clock in the morning.
What kind of a show are you guys putting on here today?
I am your father.
Agree, disagree.
Screen Time with John Fardy.
Brought to you by Stella Cinemas.
Listen and subscribe to the podcast now, or tune in this evening at 6.
On News Talk.
We're all beginning to get back to business, so it's time to let customers know. OnPost Commerce is here to help you get through. And nothing gets through to your customers like direct mail. We put your message directly into their hands and their homes, targeting key areas in your locality, delivered by a familiar face that you can trust. See how effective direct mail can be for your business at onpost.com/commerce. OnPost Commerce, for your world. Terms and conditions apply.
Afternoons are easy with InsureMyVan.ie, Ireland's low-cost van insurance specialists. Get your business back on the road with InsureMyVan's best price guarantee. For super savings, visit InsureMyVan.ie. City Financial Marketing Group Limited, training as InsureMyVan.ie, is regulated by the Central Bank of Ireland.
For more than 20 years, GS Medical has been supporting the healthcare industry. With PPE now becoming part of all our daily lives, GS Medical is continuing to support both the public and SMEs with our medical-grade PPE range. With surgical face masks from 40 cent and face shields from €2.90, we offer medical-grade quality products at exceptional prices. Order direct from our website at gsmedical.ie. GS Medical. Protect those that matter. Terms and conditions apply.
Stay connected with totally unlimited broadband from Air for just $29.99 a month for 6 months. Sign up today and keep the whole family entertained with amazing content from Amazon Prime Video on us for a whole year. Plus, you'll get the Air Sport Pack free. For more on this amazing offer, why not drop into one of our stores or visit air.ie. Air. Let's make possible. New customers only. $29.99 a month for 6 months. $49.99 a month thereafter. 12-month contract subject to availability. Bundle activation fee may apply. Full details and terms. See air.ie/Prime Video.
Whatever trip you're making, we'd love to see you in one of our award-winning Plaza motorway service stations. With Supermax, Papa John's Pizza, Super Subs, Bewley's Barista and Spar, our plazas are the perfect pit stop on your journey. Now open at the Port Leash Plaza at Junction 17 on the M7.
Get even more incredible savings next time you shop at Lidl with the new Lidl Plus Rewards app. Say good luck to losing your loyalty card or realising at the till that you've left your vouchers at home. Say hello to at least €10 worth of coupons delivered to your phone every week and loads more exclusive savings in store. And for a limited time only, get €5 off your first €25 shop. So download now. Shop, boop, save with the new Lidl Plus Rewards app. Terms and conditions apply. Saying boop is not essential, but it is a bit of crack. See Lidl.ie for more.
Once upon a time in Bundoran, some big kahuna won €12 million. Maybe a surfer chasing some epic waves. The Lotto jackpot is an estimated €6.2 million. Play responsibly, in-store, in-app, or at lottery.ie. The National Lottery. It could be you.
Splunk, our news talk.
Erin Splunk is Denny, le cosna COVID-19 ag medu, Ryan and Doctor Matthew O'Toole, achurmi doin erconus marthamid ag dolinglek leshen virus. La Roy Gemmet Ryan in fi TikTok vi Trump, agus dare more trasni chalaglin fi conus a chauro I hava codulta e the haspont of sport.
Splunk, le cuon o flaharta, our news talk.
Eish dag subscribe leshen podchrail in ish ernewstalk.com, new air app, news talk.
I work for a living. I work all my days. Who could have predicted this extraordinary phase? Time stood still, the clock kept ticking. Businesses beating, trade still kicking. I'll stay strong, keep my head above water. For me, my customers and my daughter. Adapt to new ways. Work wherever I please, get paid on time, manage cash flow with ease. With experts beside me, let's press play. New tomorrows start today.
New Sage Accounting. Try it free for 3 months at sage.ie. Charges apply after third month unless cancelled.
On 106 to 108 FM.
On newstalk.com.
On smart speaker.
And on the Newstalk app. This is Newstalk.
It's 2 o'clock. Good afternoon. Garda checkpoints are in place across Kildare, Laois and Offaly to make sure residents comply with new COVID-19 restrictions. People are being asked to only travel out of the counties for essential reasons like medical appointments, work or for childcare. It follows a spike in coronavirus cases in recent weeks. The HSE's also moved to set up new pop-up testing centres in the counties in Newbridge and Port Laois. CEO Paul Reid outlines the work that has taken place.
We're increasing our resourcing and our public health teams in those areas. Our contact testing and tracing, we've increased the numbers of people over the weekend and throughout next week in our contact tracing. Our testing centres, we've increased the opening hours of the centres that exist, and we've also increased centres this morning.
Weddings are among the events affected, with indoor gatherings now restricted to 6 people from 3 households, while a maximum of 15 people are allowed to attend outdoor gatherings. Ger Alley from the Heritage in Killinard in County Laois says a wedding was due to take place at the hotel next weekend.
I had to make a phone call last night
at 7 o'clock, and just to tell them that we wouldn't be able to fulfil their needs on our property. And that couple have a significant deposit paid with us, so we will have to reimburse that.
In other news, two men have been remanded in custody in connection with a €3 million drug seizure in Dublin. The heroin was discovered at Rosemont Business Park on Wednesday. Ben Finnegan reports.
41-year-old Andrew Noonan with an address at Red Hills Park, Ellistown, County Kildare, and 31-year-old Keith Quinn of Monastery Gate Avenue in Clondalkin appeared in court earlier. They've been charged with possession of illegal drugs and possession with intent to supply. Mr Justice John Brennan said the charges were serious and refused bail for both men. Mr Quinn and Mr Noonan have been remanded in custody to appear at Cloverhill District Court on August 13th.
And an investigation's continuing into a huge explosion in Beirut earlier this week in which 154 people died. Around 300,000 people are unable to return home after buildings, doors and windows were damaged by the shockwaves. Officials believe it could cost upwards of €12 billion to repair the damage. It's 2 minutes past two.
News Talk weather.
Thanks to the AA. Download the new AA app to request a roadside rescue and track the patrol right to your car.
A warm and dry day with good sunny spells, highest temperatures of 19 to 24 degrees. And now you're up to date on News Talk.
The Saturday panel on Off the Ball.
This is Off the Ball Saturday on News Talk. John Duggan with you through till 5 o'clock. You can text us on 53106. Tweet us at Off the Ball. We're streaming live as well. You can watch us on the Off the Ball social channels for Periscope and Twitter at Off the Ball, on YouTube, on Facebook. And we're also streaming on the new OTB Sports app. We're chatting to local radio legends in Gaelic games on the Saturday panel. Liam Spratt, who's been commentating on Wexford GAA for Southeast Radio for 30 years. Oisin Kelly, who calls it in Donegal for Highland Radio. And Willie Quinlan, who knows all things Carlow for KCLR, also played for the Intercounty team. Lads, thanks so much for joining us. Liam, you've had many great days, I'd say, following Wexford. Maybe 96 was the best time of it as well.
Yeah, it was, John. And, you know, funny enough, people always ask me about 96. And the one great memory I have of 96 is I was lucky enough to be on the bus on the way down, reporting live back at base. And for me, that was the highlight because the crowd started across the bridge when we left Stillorgan, and it just got bigger and bigger. There'd be a lot of passion in Wicklow for Wexford hurling. And it just got bigger and bigger. And I think it took us about 8 hours to get to Wexford Road. For me, that was the most, ironically, that was the most memorable thing about it. But 96 was great. When you don't win an All-Ireland every year, you know, obviously when you do win one, I never thought it would happen. But I'd have to say another great memory, John, was I never thought Wexford footballers would get to an All-Ireland semi-final.
Yeah.
And I've already mentioned Jason Ryan tonight and or today. And I couldn't believe, and if we had have had a bit more belief in that All-Ireland semi-final against Tyrone, we got within 4 points of them, and Matty Ford went off at half-time injured, and Kieran Ling scored one of the goals of the season. So that was another highlight as well, I'd have to say, because I come from a background of a football club. Ballyhogue is the name of the club. And that, for me, was another highlight, John. And, of course, Wexford is so multi-tasked in sport. For example, this week we had Harry Tector, who's from Wexford, who played with his grandfather, Bill, played rugby for Ireland, and then he played for the local J club here in Clovon under a pseudonym because of the ban. And we had a young fella from Wexford who signed for Harlequins as a scrum half, Jack Stafford, this week. So that'll give you an idea of the variety of sport that we have in this county.
Of course, Aidan O'Brien, Kevin Doyle as well there, Liam.
I'm still disappointed, by the way, John, that you left Aidan O'Brien out of your ambassador pick.
Well, it wasn't me. You left him out of Mount Rushmore. I don't know if you saw the Carlo and Donegal one, John. Lads, but I got enough stick for the Dublin one. And Liam as well, like we were speaking to Willie there before the break, do you feel liberated to almost have the yellow belly jersey on when you got the microphone on a match day?
Well, as I said earlier, John, you know, we can be biased, you know, which on national radio, you have to give probably a more even picture, but I suppose we can let ourselves go and be biased. Actually, we would take credit, I'd say, local radio for the first people to introduce a co-commentator, because when local radio started, I don't work full-time in local radio, but when it started, I realised that I needed an expert. I had never played inter-county. I played it to a decent level, but never played to a level. enough. So we introduced co-commentators because I realized very quickly that you need some expert along side you to do that. But and that we were instrumental in that. And that kind of, you know, you kind of can put the boys on the spot, so to speak, and be looking at you funny, you know. And I suppose that's one element that's different. You know, Nathan and your commentators, they have to be, they can't really be that biased unless Ireland are playing. So we have that privilege of maybe adding that little bit of bias to our commentary, which I suppose, and then we can lose the plot sometimes, which I suppose adds to the excitement.
I was asking Willie about the maddest moment there. The maddest moment for you, Liam, was?
Well, John, I'm well known for my bloopers down here, I suppose. The referee threw in the whistle and all those kind of stuff. There's a Sprattisms page down here, which I don't know much about, but I'm well known for the bloopers, John, and mad moments. I remember doing commentary Wexford were playing Offaly in Burr, and it was on the up on the roof, and I started singing that song, Up on the Roof. And I remember in Wicklow two years ago, we were actually playing Wicklow on football, and the only place we could get a signal was on the roof in Ockram, and there's a picture of myself and Seamus Fitzhenry, who was a great footballer with Wexford, Damien's brother, and two brollies over us, and we were nearly like Mary Poppins. We were trying to keep the brollies from blowing away. So they're mad moments. I mean, luckily it's radio and people don't see those kind of things happening.
And Oisin, you know, you're editing up there in Highland as well, and you've got to put it together, a GAA broadcast. So for example, like you'd have a person beside you, like, say, for example, Martin McHugh, who might have his sons playing, and you might have to keep him in check and that kind of thing as well.
Well, that's can be difficult at times. Martin can be a bit emotional when it comes to having family in the field, which he can totally understand. And you're on about memories. If we go back to the 2014...
Yeah.
Semi-final against Dublin, John. The last time that the Dubs were beating the championship game, Martin was on co-commentary. And you're on about memories. That's the day that we sort of lost the run of ourselves, because we went into a game that nobody was giving us a hope of winning. Paul Durkin pulled off a save in the first half, which kept us in the match. And then Jim McGuinness then decided to turn the screw. So he did on the game. And young Ryan played a big part that day, scored two goals and 2 points. So myself and Martin, it was the biggest game that we had probably, because I wasn't commentating in 2012. So that was probably the biggest game in my commentary career and probably to date as well, my fondest memory. So yeah, Martin sort of got really into the game, and obviously with Ryan playing, and he had Mark previously as well and teams as well. Obviously, not that you keep him in check, but at times you can hear him when maybe the boys might have made a mistake that... he might have let our Ryan or our Mark go or things like that. But listen, Martin is a top match analyst, so he is, and he knows his football. He's an astute man when it comes to football. And he's the, as Liam said there, you need guys of expertise of that level beside you that know what they're talking about, to bring, I suppose, the local commentator's performance to the people of Donegal. And yes, you do be biased. So you do, but I think that's what makes local radio special, so it is, John.
Would you, as a kind of a co-commentator there, Willie, down in Carlo, kind of have to, you know, people are probably coming up to you or, what'd you say about that person or this person? You probably have to deal with negativity at times as well as positivity.
Yeah, actually, a funny story. Last year, Aerog played Sarsfields in the club championship, and my own fella came on as a sub, and sideline ball, and we're deciding, will he kick it, won't he kick it, will he play it short? And I said, oh, no, he should kick it over. This was out on the sideline, probably 21 yards from the end line. So anyway, he kicks the ball, and it's straight over the bar. So you're getting a bit excited when you're on, you're watching your own kicking it, you know, as well as your club. And next, the fullback came and struck him an elbow, and I just totally forgot myself and said, for fuck's sake.
Excuse the language.
On the radio. Yeah, excuse the language. Sorry, lads. But in the meantime, my phone buzzed. Somebody had texted me, do you realise what you're after saying? And I just said to Brenno, sorry about that, lads. So the referee anyway came to deal with it, and he sent off the fullback a straight red and a black card for my own lad, Niall. And I'm looking and I'm thinking, what in the name of God is he after doing? Seemingly now, looking down at it, the referee couldn't see or hear him saying anything. But seemingly what happened, he said something back to the fullback. Fullback came and gave him a dunt. And of course, I got so excited and carried away. And him, after being floored, a little curse came out. But I was reminded straight away on the phone, do you realise what you're after saying? So you can get carried away. And Liam is right. We are very biased. You're very biased with your club, with your county. But you do have to kind of put tabs on it. I have two lads now that are playing. One is a minor and Niall is obviously a senior. And I've done a couple of matches with both of them. And you do find yourself, you know, when they do make a mistake, you're nearly saying, oh, what are you doing? And you're nearly forgetting that you have the headphones on. So you do have to keep yourself intact at all stages. If you don't, you can just forget where you are and forget what you're saying.
Absolutely, yeah. I think that's definitely identifiable, Willie. What happened in Donegal in 12 and 14, it must have changed everything how you kind of covered GAA, because this was 20 years after 1992, Oisin. It had been a long time. You weren't expected possibly to make the breakthrough. It must have done a huge amount for the local community.
It was a serious injection to Gaelic football and the county, John. If you go back a year before Jim McGuinness came on board, Donegal football was at a bit of a low point. You were gone from the first round of the qualifiers. And we had this group of players, and there was a transition coming, Jim McGuinness. At the third time of trying, eventually got the Donegal job. As we all know the story of how Jim McGuinness came aboard in Donegal and what he achieved in such a short period of time. Because it was a four-year plan, he ended up winning an All-Ireland in 2 years. But the injection into football, as I said, was phenomenal after that. It really lifted the sport, and it lifted the interest in the sport as well. You've seen it grow. You've seen the numbers at underage are participating as well. And when you bring the Sam Maguire and an All-Ireland winning team back to the county, and you go to the 39 clubs that are in Donegal, they didn't miss one. And you see these youngsters are seeing these guys as their heroes. They all decided to join the clubs and get back playing football. And we've seen what came after that, because Donegal got on a bit of a run then. We started to win Ulster minor titles, so we did. We've seen it in 2014 where Donegal actually had two teams, first time ever in an All-Ireland final, the minors and the seniors, both beaten by Big Kerry. And then that followed on again where there was the Donegal teams winning under-21 championships. So there was a knock-on effect with the younger groups coming through. So there wasn't, as we know at this stage now, Donegal are consistently seen as one of the top sides of the country when it comes to championship. And now they haven't got to the same level as what they did in 14. And when you mentioned maybe 14, John, that was the one that got away.
Yeah,
that's how we feel up here about it. The day we beat Dublin, we were given the hot ticket of being All-Ireland winners for 2014. Did that play a role? I don't know. Everybody's seen Donegal, and you beat the invincible Dubs. Now you're going to take on Kerry. There were certain corners were warning us, going, don't rule Kerry out yet. Kerry people might like me saying this, but that was probably not one of the worst Kerry teams, but one of the Kerry teams that wouldn't be seen as the glamour teams of the past that actually won in All-Ireland. Maybe if Colin McFadden's effort didn't come off the post and ended up in the back of the net and there was a replay, we could have ended up beating Kerry the next day by 12 or 13 points, but that's what some have suggested. It may have happened, it may not have happened, but that would be the one that got away. But that golden period of Jim McGuinness, without doubt, there was a knock-on effect in the county, and young people started taking up Gaelic football again. People started taking Gaelic football serious. Young players started taking Gaelic football serious. Because the modern day, John, when you get as far as 15, 16, 17 years of age, you now have a choice to make in whatever sport you're going to play. There are certain athletes in this county that are good that in any sport that they touch, be it athletics, be it soccer, be it Gaelic games, be it rugby. But these guys, when they get to that age, 15, 16, 17, have to make a choice of what way they're going to go. And off the back of what happened, a lot of them went the Gaelic games route again and stuck with Gaelic football. And yes, we have seen underage teams succeeding. Declan Bonner's the man in charge now. There's been a lot of the guys that he is in there that he's taken up from 16 into minor and into under 21. And obviously their ultimate goal now is to try and repeat what Jim McGuinness did for Declan and his players to get an All-Ireland. But will there be an All-Ireland this year? We don't even know if there's going to be an inter-county ball kick, John. So we'll have to wait and see.
Liam, like when you're talking about passion of the local clubs, and I'm sure when you're commentating, the crowds are really, really passionate about, even if it's a small crowd, about their clubs. Have you seen a marked, like, is it worth it at the moment having the club game with no crowds? Effectively, this 200 thing is just like, that's effectively behind closed doors. Liam? Seem to have an issue with Liam's line there. Oisin, I just want to put that question to you. Do you see an actual, a real difference commentating or covering GA matches behind closed doors effectively, which they are, as opposed to having passionate crowds as you would in local battles up in Donegal? I think we're going to try the third time lucky here with Willie. We're having technical issues today on the show, and we apologise for that. Willie, are you seeing a big marked difference in the way the games are actually coming across to the naked eye?
Yeah, huge. Just no atmosphere at all, John. And if you're watching every sport, I mean, every sport is back now. The Premiership came back there without any crowds. And the games are just not the same. They're not the same. You don't have that atmosphere. You don't have the crowd on the edge and people, you know, shouting and roaring. So it's definitely not the same in Carlow at a local stage when there's not that many at the pitch. That buzz is not around of the people, say, arriving, handful of people at a time, and everybody's trying to keep their distance. So is it worth it? I don't think it is, John. I don't think it's worth it at the moment for a health point of view. And if it keeps getting worse the way it's going, the way Laois, Kildare and Offaly are going, you know, it's very difficult to see a championship intercounty being played this year.
Is it worth it, Liam, at the moment? I'm afraid we're having issues with the lines here. We do apologise to our listeners. It was interesting the fact that Willie, that Oisin was speaking about how like Donegal GA has changed with the success. Like I'm even thinking, like, if Carlow played in a Division 4 or Division 3 league, or even for the Tailteann Cup in the summer, and you maybe had the provinces earlier in the year, do you think it would change the impact of Carlow GA on the people in the county in a way that is higher than it is now?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, obviously we watch other counties, and You're looking at Donegal back that time, and it had to be a huge influence on, as he said, winning minors and under 21s. And, you know, if any club or any county gets the success that the likes of Donegal or the likes of Donegal, you know, Dublin are getting at the moment, it has to be a knock-on effect, John. It has to be, you know, the kids look at it, and he's right. When you get to 15, 16, 17 now, there's so much involved in if you go with a county, an inter-county team, because you have your gym maybe 2 or 3 days a week, you're on the field 2 or 3 days. It's nearly gone to professional stage at the level. So you have to make your choice at 16 or 17. And if a club or a county is going really, really well, we're definitely going to decide, I'll stick with GAA, or if, you know, if soccer's going well, I'll stick with soccer. So it's a massive effect. If Carlow, you know, could get out of Division 4 again into 3 and do well in the championship, I think it definitely has a big effect for the kids looking at that for the future.
Liam, I feel like I'm up on the roof today. The club game returning in Wexford, has it been worth it so far?
It's been the best hurling championship I've seen for a long time, John, because it was in 4 groups of 3. So effectively, it's a knockout championship, and it's been brilliant. And as I said, I think first when I spoke to you today, that the intra-county players are absolutely flying. Heretofore,
even though they can't train, this is now with their clubs, Liam, yeah?
Yeah, with their clubs, John. Yeah, when heretofore they would have played with the county. Our hurlers, as you know, got to the All-Ireland semi-final last year. But players look tired when they come back to their club then. The fact that they're fresh and they've been with the club training and playing for the last 4 or 5 weeks, you can see the difference in their performance on the field. We've had, it is, in Wexford, normally we would have senior hurling 1 week because we have a unique situation where most of our senior hurling clubs play senior football as well. And a lot of the senior hurlers are very good footballers and vice versa. So we have a situation where they would play hurling 1 week, football the next week. And I think that's to the detriment of the quality of both games, because you're playing hurling 1 week, dropping the hurls, picking up a football, and then dropping the football, picking up a hurl. So the fact that we're playing hurling right out to the end of the championship, and then we're going to start football, I think has been a benefit to both games. And I think we've had a fantastic hurling championship, John. It's been the best I can remember week after week. We had four quarterfinals this weekend. We had the county champions beaten last week. We have one game this evening and we have two quarterfinals tomorrow. And it's really, really exciting. The only downside is, as Willie and Oisin have alluded to, that we've only 200 max people. And that's the only disappointment. And, you know, it's been fantastic. And I think that the GAA will learn from this. I think county boards will see the benefit of playing the club championship and the quality of the games that we've had. But I think down the road, John, this might be a dramatic change for our GAA generally.
Yeah, we asked Willie this before the break. The GPA's proposal about a 23-week season from February till July and then having the club season in the rest of the year. Would that be something then that might actually work based on what you're seeing, Liam?
I think they're going to have to look at the whole thing, John. I think the lads are saying that we mightn't have inter-county games. I think we mightn't have inter-county games, maybe not because of COVID, largely because of COVID, but because of the financial implications. If Wexford, who Davy Fitzgerald and the Paul Galvin now in charge of the football, if the county teams go back training, it's going to cost the same amount of money for your managers, for your players, travelling expenses. How do they go to games? Do they go separately in cars or do they go on buses? And I think it's come down to the whole financial end of it as well, that it's going to be, you know, that it's going to be too expensive to actually run the championship unless TV stations pony up with the money. And I can't see that happening. So I think down the road, you know, a lot of things have changed in life because of COVID. A lot of people have, you know, even there's a problem with people involved with teams being at home for a couple of months saying, do I need this pressure being involved with a team? So there's a whole mindset. And I think if the GAA sit down, they're going to have to learn from this, John. And I think a lot of sports will learn from it. And it might be to the betterment of players' welfare, I think, in the long run.
Yeah, I would agree with that. And I would also say that maybe just this year, just to get it actually something done, the way you're speaking there, Liam, about actually having a brilliant championship with Wexford, maybe we just need to just take the financial hit, the GAA, who do have assets, to say, you know what, we'll just get a championship of some description just for people's almost mental well-being to get it done. But I do think, like, longer term, we need to completely reimagine how we do this. Oisin, are you seeing the same kind of vibe that the club players are fresher in Donegal and that actually, you know what, we need to rethink about the restructure here?
Well, if you look at this year, the way things are set up, the club championship's up and running. We've actually got an extra game this year in the club championship, John. They're playing four rounds and then end the knockout. So if you're going to get to the final, so maybe it's like last year we had Niamh Connell and Gidore, who have an abundance of county players involved in both squads, and they go the whole way to the final. You're in very, very good shape physically, match sharpness as you head back to your inter-county training and back into inter-county come September time. So, and one way you couldn't ask for better preparation, given the matches are coming thick and fast. They're well tuned at that stage, and then you're going into inter-county level matches. Maybe the fact that you haven't played a game at inter-county level, at that level, might maybe not so much be to the detriment of the result of the match for the team, but it might take a couple of games to get up to speed, command the championship. So there's sort of pros and cons, there's yeses and nos to it, but from a player point of view, I think that those that are involved with the county setup, and particularly those involved in the top four sides in the county, will be in very, very good condition come championship and those league games if they go ahead in October. But there's a lot of other variables when you're talking about fixtures, as Liam mentioned and yourself there, John, that condense, and the GPA can say they want to condense this down to 23 weeks. That's okay. But if you start to add in the likes of the minors and add in the under-21s, you're going to have players that's involved, or the under-20s, excuse me, that's involved with under 20 county panels. They're involved with senior panels as well. They're also possibly involved with Sigerson's. There was, of course, action earlier in the year that was affected due to that. Then you add in the provincial club situation after the county championships are played. Ulster's a wee bit different, John. They want to have their championships played the way they have. They hold like the Ulster Championship and the Ulster Club Championship trophies and the winners. They see that as very, very, very important. And from an Ulster point of view, I can't see them changing their competitions to suit possibly the rest of the country if they're going to rejig a championship from 2021 on. Some quarters say that maybe put the senior championship into a couple of tiers, and have different groups and have it as 16 teams. And there's a lot of sort of questions to be asked going forward. But I know from an Ulster point of view that they hold their championship so importantly that I don't think they're going to give up an Ulster championship maybe to suit the rest of the country.
Okay, we've got about 2 minutes between the three of you guys. Obviously, we've got a public health issue here. That's the most important thing. We need to get through it, and hopefully everybody can. But the day you return to, say, Croke Park or an inter-county championship match, what is the day you're looking the most forward to briefly about returning behind the commentary box for a massive game there? Willie, you want to start with you?
Yeah, I suppose definitely you'd be hoping, first of all, that there was going to be a bit more of a crowd. But obviously, with health and safety, the crowds are going to stay low. It's that atmosphere that, you know, meeting people on the way in, it's the buzz of the game. Prior to playing, I suppose, playing the game, when you are playing and you're involved in it, there's a huge buzz around it. But this is the next best thing to it is a local radio. You're looking for, you know, your county to stand up in the championship. And we're looking for another day out like we got against Kildare, which was a couple of years ago. It was fantastic. And it's just to get that inter-county on the road again. And you know, hopefully we will see it, but not too sure if we will, John.
Okay, Willie. Liam, for you, what are you looking forward to most? Wexford win that All-Ireland?
Wexford went very close last year, John, as we know, and there's a feeling that they might have gone even a little bit closer this year if we are to have a hurling championship. We're excited about Paul Galvin of the footballers. He's upset a few people in the early stages, but he's brought in a young team to play. He knows the way he wants to play football, and that's what I'd be really looking forward to. We've had the advantage of commentating. We're commentating in all the senior hurling games played in Chadwick's Wexford Park, so we've had the advantage of already being back on air. And of course, as you know, John, when you're local, you'll meet the fella, you know, be saying, "Jesus, Brad, what was that you were on about there yesterday? What are you saying about this?" So that's the other downside to being a local commentator on local radio, that, you know, people know you and they can have a go at you. You're an easy target sometimes, but look, that's what you put yourself up for. It's just I'm always conscious, John, that there's a lot of people sick at home. There's a lot of people unwell.
Yeah.
There's a lot of people love to be at the game, can't be at the game, and you're really painting a picture for them. And they're the people that I think of a lot when we actually stand in front of a mic. And it's like playing. Some days you'll have what you consider a good day, and some days you'll say to yourself when you're finished, "Geez, that was a bad one. What were you thinking of today?"
Yeah.
So, you know, it's a bit like playing, John.
Absolutely, Liam. And for you, Oisin, what are you looking forward to the most?
Fingers crossed we get the go-ahead for Donegal Tyrone on the 31st of October, because Donegal are going for 3 in a row Ulster titles, which they haven't done before under the guidance of Declan Boner and been led by their captain, Michael Murphy. And matches don't get any bigger, John, than when you meet your nearest rivals and your neighbours, Donegal against Tyrone. It's going to be a fascinating fixture, so it is. And it's certainly going to be the first defining moment of the Ulster Championship. And from a Highland point of view, I concur with John says that we provide a service, or what Liam said rather, we provide a service to the local people. And you do have the football fanatics, but you also have to remember, a man told me once, you have to remember the old lady sitting at the range, and you have to paint that picture and tell the story for her, and you have to make her become a Donegal football fanatic as well. And that's what local radio was all about. And when you're telling people the story of Donegal and Tyrone meeting in McCool Park on the 31st of October in the championship quarter-final, you don't get any bigger stages than that, John.
Well, Oisin Kelly, Willie Quinlan and Liam Spratt, thanks so much for being great sports today to share your stories and being with us on Saturday the panel. Take care.
Thanks, John. Thank you.
Here's John.
This is Off the Ball Saturday on News Talk. 53106 for your text messages. Back after this.
Off the Ball on News Talk.
At Volkswagen Financial Services, our solutions are expertly engineered to put you in the driving seat. Choose the flexibility of PCP, low-cost HP finance, or the convenience of leasing. Add extras like servicing and maintenance plans. For Volkswagen, Audi, Skoda, SEAT or Volkswagen commercial vehicles, discover financing options that match your needs and your budget. Talk to your local dealer or visit vwfs.ie/affordability. Volkswagen Financial Services. Affordability engineered for you.